This is the fourth in the series of instrument flying videos I'm making for PPLIR Europe, covering how to fly final approaches. Before you scour YouTube or hunt through for the box set, I admit that I've gone all George Lucas on you and made video number four before I make numbers two and three. The idea is that the overall sequence, basic instrument flying, tracking, holding, approaches and PBN, form a sequential course. But while people are in lockdown practicing their skills, it seems to me that they will be more interested in approaches than tracking and holding. I found that using the techniques in this video, I've managed to teach even quite experienced instrument pilots to fly approaches not only more accurately, more stably and safer, but also with considerably less brain power engaged. Once you've learned these techniques and practiced them, you should not only be able to fly a perfect approach to minimum and beyond, but be able to order fuel and a taxi while you do so. As in the basic instrument flying video, I'm really only talking about piston aircraft in the range of the Cessna 172 to Navajo, whether they have six-pack or glass. I do recommend, if you can, practicing these techniques over and over again on the simulator, preferably a simulator with force feedback controls. That way you can practice the basic skills without being limited by air traffic control. You'll be able to fly the final approach repetitively without having to fly patterns or procedures. You can set the weather, particularly the wind and wind shear, to whatever you want to practice. And of course, it's much lower cost or free. So you can do as many as you like until you always get it right. There's lots of advice on using sims to learn and practice IMC and IFR on the PPLIR Europe forum, where you can also contact me directly if you wish. This video is only about the intermediate and final approach segments, rather than flying the procedural initial approach, though I'll talk about the turn onto final approach. This is partly because most approaches these days are radar vectored, though PBN is reintroducing the procedure to some extent. But that is subject of another video. But mainly because flying a procedure is a different set of skills, so I'm lumping it with tracking rather than approaches. People often teach approaches with and without vertical guidance as two separate exercises. I think that this is misguided. If you fly an approach with vertical guidance, that is ILS or LPV, as if you were flying a two-dimensional approach, you will find that staying on the glide path right down to minima and beyond is much easier. I'm going to start by taking you back to a couple of words you probably hoped you'd never hear again once you've been introduced to the magenta line. Dead reckoning. You did it to death in basic training, but let's just remind ourselves of the fundamental concept. You start by estimating what inputs you need to achieve the performance you want. For example, you calculate a heading to achieve a track. Then you test that estimate out by flying your estimate for a period and seeing what the resulting error is. You double and reverse that error for the same length of time, then halve the correction back. So, if you want to fly 090 degrees and calculate a heading of 100 degrees to achieve that, you fly 100 for 5 minutes and calculate your position and thereby your track error. Let's say the track error is 5 degrees to the right. You double that and reverse it. So you turn left 10 degrees for 5 minutes, then halve it back again, turning right by 5 degrees, and you should not only be back on track, but you should stay on track. I do hope that I've reminded you of something long forgotten, but now at the forefront of your mind. I'm going to suggest to you that you use that technique both laterally and vertically during approaches. I'll come back to that, but please make sure that you've got the concept and that if you don't, rewind a couple of minutes and go through it again with me. There is another exercise that I'd like you to do, whether on the aircraft or the sim, before we go any further. So once I've described it, put me on pause, go off and do it, and come back to me when you're done. Determine, whether from the POH or your personal experience, what airspeed you're going to fly final approaches. You can just take the VAT from the POH, but many of us who fly regularly in bigger airports in the company of big jets know that we normally fly faster than that. ATC often demand 150 knots to 4 nautical miles, and we try to give it to them. But anyway, just decide the speed you're comfortable with in your aircraft. Then try to fly into about a 10 knot headwind. On the sim, that's easy to set up, but in the aircraft, just do your best. If the wind is stronger, fly at an angle to it such the headwind component is about 10 knots. If lighter, well, too bad. I only say 10 knots because it's a sort of average headwind on the ILS. This aspect is not critical. Calculate the rate of descent required at that ground speed, i.e. 10 knots less than your indicated airspeed. This is most easily achieved by dividing your ground speed by 2 and multiplying by 10. So 100 knots halved is 50, multiplied by 10 is 500 feet per minute. This isn't totally accurate, and I give the accurate figure in this table. Now, set the aircraft up to fly straight and level at that speed at about 2,000 feet. If you have retractable gear, fly with one stage of flaps. If you have fixed gear, fly clean. Trim absolutely perfectly using the technique I showed you in the basic instrument flying video. Note the power setting. It's likely to be around 17 inches or 2000 RPM on a fixed pitch prop, but get the exact figure for your aircraft. Now, in a retractable aircraft, lower the gear and allow the nose to drop to 2.5 degrees nose down. Your rate of descent will probably be very close to that calculated for your airspeed. This should happen without any change to power or trim, though you may have to briefly control the nose drop. But even if you don't, it'll fugoid its way to stability quite quickly. Now you should be descending at the planned rate of descent at your preferred speed at 2.5 degrees nose down in trim. If you're not, make small changes to power and trim until you are, and note the new power setting. In a fixed gear aircraft, it's not quite so easy. Lower one stage of flap, but you will almost certainly have to retrim. But you should then get somewhere close to the 2.5 degrees nose down and the planned rate of descent at the planned speed. If you don't, adjust the power and note that power. So you now have a power setting configuration, pitch angle, indicated airspeed and rate of descent for a 3-degree slope against a 10 knot headwind. That's your go-to position for your final approach. Obviously, if the wind is stronger, or if you have a tailwind, or if the slope is steeper or ATC make you fly faster, those figures will change. But if you know what a standard approach looks like, it makes it much easier to make those small adjustments. The other point I want to make before we move on is that the calculated rate of descent is not a rule of thumb, it's a Euclidean certainty. A 3-degree slope is exactly 318 feet per nautical mile. That is fixed. If you fly at a ground speed of 60 knots, you cover a nautical mile in 1 minute. That is the definition of a knot. So at 60 knots ground speed, you need to descend 318 feet in 1 minute. That means that you need a rate of descent of 318 feet per minute, though we tend to round this to 300 feet per minute. At 120 knots, it's 636 feet per minute, and so on. Turn that round the other way. If you're doing a ground speed of exactly 90 knots at the final approach fix to a 3-degree slope, and you maintain that ground speed all the way down, then, if you descend at 477 feet per minute, you will, by the laws of trigonometry, end up at the Pappies. If you round that to 450 feet a minute, to keep it simple, you'll end up a few metres past the Pappies, but well within the touchdown zone. My point is this. You do not need the glide path indicator. Sure, it's reassuring and saves you the effort of checking your altitude every mile, but if you fly an accurate ground speed and an accurate rate of descent, is exactly the same as going down the glide path. I once had this demonstrated beautifully when I was training a student and we had to divert to a Royal Air Force base in unforecast, pretty awful weather. The glide slope kept failing. They clearly knew this because they kept passing check altitudes, but it was never actually mentioned. The result was that most of the time we had a glide slope flag, but every so often the glide slope popped up. I got him to fly a very accurate speed and rate of descent, and every time the slope popped up, it was bang in the middle. It was a marvellous demonstration, and I wish I could bottle it. So, the obvious upshot of all that is that you fly an approach in the same way, whether there's vertical guidance or not. You fly attitude, speed, and rate of descent, and the result is the same, glide path indicator or no glide path indicator. That way, you do not fall into the trap of chasing the glide path indicator, with the inevitable consequences of loss of stability and pilot-induced oscillation. I know that there are some exponents of the dive and drive method for an approach without vertical guidance, and there's an advisory paper on the subject on the website. But it's far from my recommendation, and you'll need to find someone else to instruct you on that if that is what you want to do. All approaches have three segments before the missed approach point: the initial segment, the intermediate segment, and the final segment. As I said earlier, we're not going to talk about the initial approach in this video. We're just going to talk about the level intermediate approach and the descending final approach. The intermediate approach starts at the intermediate fix, ideally is level and on the same track as the final approach, and ends at the final approach or fix. The final approach is from the final approach point or fix to the missed approach point and continues the same track as the intermediate leg. Unfortunately, some intermediate segments contain a small descent. I wish they didn't, because it interferes with the methodology I'm going to describe in a minute. By the way, does everyone know the difference between final approach point and final approach fix? Of course, they don't make it simple, do they? In ICAO, I don't think there is a difference. Either is the start of the final approach segment. But in the US, and hence in Jeppesen, it's only called the final approach fix if there's an actual fix there, while the final approach point is where the platform altitude intercepts the final approach slope. I wouldn't worry about it too much. Most people refer to it as the final approach fix any which way, because there's usually a DME fix or RNAV waypoint there. There are a small number of approaches, the NDB at Calais springs to mind, where there's no defined final approach fix or final approach point, but they are exceptional and we needn't worry about them in this short video. To save breath confusion, I'll refer to the final approach fix from now on and just put up with any pedantry that comes my way in the comments. I like to think of the intermediate segment as the rehearsal for the final approach. On this segment, we must achieve two things: a bracketed heading and a trimmed stable configuration. If we do this properly, the final approach is more or less a non-event. But we don't have very long to do it in, so we need to be reasonably quick, decisive, and accurate. But we'll never have enough time in the intermediate segment unless we establish on the correct track quickly and precisely. If we spend 30 seconds or a minute faffing around not getting on the localizer or final approach track, then there will not be time to rehearse the final approach, and we can be pretty certain then to have a messy, high workload final approach. So let's spend a minute talking about establishing on that center line. Firstly, we need to have a reasonable estimate of what the heading on final approach is going to be. And for this, you need to know the wind. Even if you don't have a 2,000 foot wind, at the very least, you're going to know the surface wind from the ATIS. So if that's all you have, add 30 degrees and double it. In the southern hemisphere, subtract 30 degrees. So if the surface wind is 240/10, the best guess at the 2,000 foot wind is 30 degrees clockwise to 270 and 10 double to 20, so 270/20. But if you know the 2,000 foot wind, so much the better. Take a guess about how that wind is going to affect your heading on final approach. Don't try to be too picky, just make a guess as to which side of the final approach you're going to point, and guess at 5, 10 or 15 degrees, depending on the approximate crosswind component. That's good enough for the time being. Also, note whether, as you turn on, you're going to be blown onto the center line or you'll have to fight a headwind to get on. Obviously, if you're being blown onto it, you want to start the turn early. And if you are into wind, leave it until you're nearly there. This is a judgment that you develop with experience, and a very good exercise to do repetitively on the sim in different wind conditions. Do it until you can't get it wrong. If you're flying a teardrop procedure with the wind blowing towards the center line and there's a choice of outbound tracks, it's a good idea to choose the Cat D track, because your base turn will have a larger radius and you're less likely to get blown through the center line. If the wind is blowing you away from the center line and it looks like you're not going to establish from your current turn, reduce the angle of bank, if necessary, to straight flight, when still at a substantial angle. On a procedure, that can be 90 degrees. On radar vectoring, you're probably already on a 45 degrees from the center line, so hold that until the CDI is close to being centered. If you do end up being blown through and on the downwind side of the centre line, do not increase your bank angle beyond rate one. Just keep the turn going to re-intercept from the other side. Do this positively and reasonably aggressively so that you can get established with plenty of time. Remember, however you intercept, go to your planned heading, allowing for drift. Do not just point the nose along the centre line. If you have an HSI, a very useful trick for intercepting is the lubber line. If there's not a strong crosswind, this works beautifully. You just keep the tip of the CDI on the tip of the lubber line and you will inevitably end up established. In crosswinds, you need to lead or lag the lubber line, the amount of lead or lag depending on the crosswind component. But again, if you use the lubber line technique, you must stop the turn or keep the turn going to the planned heading. Do not just turn onto the QDM. Sorry to go on about this, but I see so many students and even quite experienced instrument pilots doing this, thus setting themselves up for many seconds of correction, eating into that valuable rehearsal time on the intermediate segment. Okay, enough of that. We're now established on the centre line, flying approximately the correct heading to remain on it. Our job over the next 2 or 3 miles is to make sure that we are on exactly the right heading to track the centre line. There are a number of techniques to do this, depending on the equipment available. If you have glass, it's super easy. The diamond-shaped track indicator or marker tells you what track you're flying, regardless of the heading and desired track. If you're on the centre line and the track marker is on the tip of the course pointer, then you will remain on the centre line and you can't do otherwise. So let's say that the ILS is 351 and you have a wind from the right. You might have to fly a heading of 360, but so long as the track marker is on 351, you will fly the localizer precisely. Some people find the track pointer a bit disorientating, as you have to fly away from it to move it. So if it says 265 and you want it to say 270, you have to turn right away from it, dragging it behind you. But if you think about what's going on, it's fairly obvious. So there's really no excuse for the glass pilot not to stay on the centre line. It's all done for you. Next, let's move on to the mechanical OBS or HSI panel that also has a GNSS moving map, such as a GTN, GNS or IFD. Again, it's made very easy because you can see the aircraft symbol painted on the desired track. If you don't have an air data computer, you need to just keep the aircraft symbol pointing along the magenta line because it represents track only and has no knowledge of heading. So long as the symbol is pointing along the magenta line, you cannot leave the center line and your job is done. If you do have an air data computer, the aircraft symbol will be at an angle to the track representing the heading and drift, but the track vector arrow shows the track. Again, just like the track indicator on the glass HSI, if you turn to place the track vector onto the center line track, you cannot go off it. For those who have a GNSS without a moving map, the answer is to display the track and the desired track and make them the same. This takes marginally more brain processing power, but it's still very easy. So if the desired track is 010 and the track is 007, you have to turn right 3 degrees. If you're flying IFR without a GNSS at all, you're left simply with the CDI to guide you, which is the way we had to do it for the first 50 years of the ILS, so quite doable. And indeed, most of the rest of this video is directed at using the CDI. In that case, just fly the planned heading and see what happens to the CDI. If it stays in the middle, that's great, you've got your heading. But more likely, because your heading is a top of your head estimate, the CDI will move slowly to one side or the other. Making sure that the heading is bracketed, in other words, finding exactly the heading that keeps you on the center line and getting the heading bug on it, is done using the dead reckoning technique I talked about at the beginning of the video. Fly your heading and every so often look at the CDI. If it moves its own width to the right, change your heading, say 4 degrees to the right. Wait until the CDI is centered, then turn back to the left by 2 degrees and then set the heading bug to that new heading. If there's any further movement, do the same thing, but this time by 2 degrees and 1 degree back, and adjust your heading bug again. You now have the perfect heading to stay on the center line, and you leave the heading bug there for the rest of the approach. We've got a long way into this video, and we've only just lined up on the center line, for which I apologize, but it's so important if you're going to get this right and make it simple. So we now have about 2 miles or 1 minute to make sure we've done two things: get the heading right and get the power and trim right. So as well as bracketing the heading, you also need to stabilize your configuration. While you're in the initial approach, or even just before, you should set the power to the setting you discovered in the exercise right at the beginning of the video. If you're flying a retractable, you should extend approach flaps, half flaps or one stage of flaps, depending on how it's calibrated. In a fixed gear aircraft, stay clean for the moment. Allow the speed to decay while raising the nose until you're stable and perfectly trimmed, flying at the approach indicated airspeed. If you can achieve this before the intermediate fix, so much the better, but you should certainly do so a good couple of miles before the final approach fix. If you need to descend in the intermediate segment, as in the example I showed you earlier, you should do it expeditiously so you can get stable as soon as possible. Now read your ground speed from either the GNSS or from the DME. In the absence of either, you just have to estimate it from your estimate of the wind. If the approach is 3 degrees, you can just multiply that ground speed by 10 and divide by 2 to get a rate of descent. Or, for any glide path angle, you can look at the plate and interpolate a rate of descent. I've often seen students fail to brief properly, miss that this slope is steeper than 3 degrees, and get quite caught out. So maybe it's a good idea to always get the rate of descent from the plate. So, following your rehearsal on the intermediate segment, you're now ready for the performance, and, like any well-rehearsed performance, that's the easy bit. As the glide slope indicator reaches about half a dot up, or, on a two-dimensional approach, you're about 0.3 of a nautical mile to the final approach fix, you lower the gear, or, if you have no gear, the first stage of flap, but keep the attitude fixed so the altitude doesn't change until the final approach fix. Then, exactly at the final approach fix, let the nose lower 2.5 degrees without a trim change, and you'll be flying the final approach. You already know your heading, power, rate of descent, and you're already in trim. What can go wrong? Well, the main thing that goes wrong is that you try to chase the needles. That's the root of nearly all messed up approaches. In my basic instrument flying video, I made the point that there's a hierarchy with a navigation instrument, typically the HSI, at the bottom, the performance instruments, heading and rate of descent, in the middle, and the attitude indicator at the top. As an exercise, both on the sim and on the aircraft, I asked the student to fly from the final approach fix to the missed approach point, flying only attitude, heading and rate of descent, with no vertical or horizontal guidance. The result is normally that they end up in a position to land from 200 feet. I then take it a step further and get them to fly from the final approach fix to the missed approach point, only looking at the attitude indicator and covering everything else up. The student is normally stunned by how it is possible to fly the whole final approach without looking at any instruments, just getting the attitude exactly right. Which brings me on to my main point. If you get the heading and rate of descent right, then the aircraft will stay on the center line and the slope. And if you get the attitude right, the heading and rate of descent will remain correct. So, I want you to focus on the final approach to reduce your command input as far as possible. Set up the attitude, the heading will remain as you set on the intermediate leg, the pitch will flow from the power setting and trim, and you're all set. So, the flow of information is, my attitude is correct, so I cannot be going far wrong. Let's have a look at my heading and rate of descent, and make a tiny adjustment to attitude if I need to, using the principles of dead reckoning. Now, very occasionally look at the center line, whether that means localizer, GPS track or ADF, and the slope, whether that means glide path indicator or check altitudes, and use that information, again, using the principles of dead reckoning, to adjust heading or rate of descent to make sure that you do not get off track laterally or vertically by adjusting attitude. If you do need to adjust your lateral tracking, always stay within the heading bug. Heading bugs are 5 degrees either side, and if you've bracketed the heading on the intermediate segment, then you'll not need to adjust it by more than that. One neat trick is, if you see the center line move slightly to one side, just go to that end of the heading bug until it's nearly back in the middle, then return to the middle of the heading bug. If you find yourself consistently going to the left end of the heading bug, then the wind is backing to the left as you descend in the northern hemisphere, and you might want to move the heading bug about 2 degrees left. Although the wind goes to the left, that could mean that drift decreases if it started from the right, or increases if it started from the left. It could even go through the nose, but then the crosswind component is small anyway. Adjusting your vertical tracking, change your pitch by a maximum of 1 degree, then half a degree back, and by a maximum of 200 feet per minute, then back 100. In both cases, any error that starts will start very slowly, but you should correct it before it's significant. For the CDI, that means about the width of the needle and definitely less than half a dot. For the slope indicator, even less. It should never really leave the central position. In a two-dimensional approach, no more than 30 feet out on the check altitude. If you adopt that methodology all the way down, the last 100 feet will feel no different to the first 100 feet. The whole thing just becomes a simple exercise in making tiny corrections. And notice that I've talked throughout about center lines and glide paths. It makes no difference whether we're talking about ILS, localizer only, LPV, LNAV, or ND approaches. The methodology is exactly the same, and I would encourage you to practice on a 2D approach first, noticing how this technique gets you through each check altitude perfectly before going on to an ILS or LPV, where you'll find that your newly found confidence on the 2D approach means that there's no temptation to chase that glide path indicator. Now, let's talk about the segment between the decision altitude and the threshold. If you've done everything that I've said so far, you will arrive at the decision point completely stable, pointing in the right direction, at the right speed and rate of descent. You must, especially in poor visibility, maintain that stability until you can see the touchdown zone, PAPI's center line and edge lighting. In an RVR of 550 meters, all you see at Cap 1 minima is something like this. In 800 meters, it's a little better, but still not great. Obviously, the place to play with this is the sim. We very rarely get the opportunity to practice very low visibility approaches. You can see elements of the approach lights, which is enough to continue to land, but you certainly don't have sufficient references to fly visually. Many less experienced pilots will instinctively push the nose forward to, I suppose, get a better view. This is plain dangerous. You're at 200 feet pointing at the ground in very poor visibility. Is that the time to start a dive? Absolutely not. So if you are hand flying, you must put in no command input at all. Having taken the decision at decision altitude, get your eyes back onto the instrument panel for about 10 to 15 seconds and make sure the picture doesn't change. Then look up again and you'll see the runway environment such that you can flare and land safely. If you've flown to decision altitude on autopilot, there's a debate to be had as to when you disengage it. The POH is very likely to say that it must not be used below 200 feet, so purists would stick to the letter of that limitation and disengage as soon as the decision is taken. My view is that the danger of going unstable at 200 feet in poor visibility is greater than the danger of a possible autopilot runaway at that point. This is not an argument I can win with the purist. He is, of course, absolutely right from a certification point of view. So you have to take your own decision on that one. The only thing I would say is decide well in advance whether you're going to fly the autopilot to 200 feet or 100 feet. Don't be starting that decision-making process at 200 feet. Next, let's talk flaps. You'll remember that you've flown a stable approach from the final approach fix to the decision point with approach flap set. When, if ever, are you going to lower landing flap? My view is that if you first see the runway environment anything lower than about 300 feet, the answer is to land on approach flaps. In addition, you should not lower full flap until a landing is assured and you have a landing clearance. This is particularly true in MEPs, where the flaps must not be deployed above the single engine committal height. There are a number of reasons for this. In any aircraft, lowering full flap is going to disturb stability by definition. And with low cloud bases or visibility, you need stability. In aircraft where there's any risk of asymmetric deployment, which means any aircraft which does not have a torque tube connecting the flaps, then you must assume that any time you deploy flaps, they could be asymmetric. You don't want that happening at 200 feet with no external reference. And in a twin, once you deploy flaps, you're committed to land in the event of an engine failure, which could happen at any time, including in the go-around. So that means you mustn't deploy them until a landing is assured, which means being able to see the runway, being cleared to land, and being set up and stable for the landing. There's no real hazard in landing a light aircraft with approach flaps, as there are really no runways with 200-foot precision heights, which are short enough to be of concern. Finally, we need to talk about the go-around. I just have one thing to say about that, which is that you must remember to pitch up. I've seen too many pilots going full power, gear up, flaps up, while accelerating fast towards the ground. Go straight to 8 degrees nose up before anything else. That's what's going to get you away from the ground. I do hope that was useful and has given you things to think about in practice. Have fun practicing and see you in the next video.